This is an auto-narrated audiobook, generated by Google. Book The Commercial Restraints of Ireland by John Hely Hutchinson. Life of Provost Hely Hutchinson. The Right Hon. John Hely Hutchinson, author of The Commercial Restraints, was certainly one of the most remarkable men that this country ever produced, and he took, amidst an unequaled combination of brilliant rivals, a very prominent part in the most interesting and splendid period of Ireland's internal history. He was, according to Dr. Dugnan, a man of humble parents. He entered Trinity College as a pensioner in the year 1740 under the name John Hely, and after his marriage he adopted the name Hutchinson, on succeeding to the estate of his wife's uncle. In 1744 he obtained his B.A., and Dugnan admits that in his undergraduate course he won some premiums at the quarterly examinations. In 1765, he was presented with the degree of LL.D. honoris causa. The college calendar in the list of provosts has 1774. The R.T. Hun, John Hely Hutchinson, LL.D., educated in Trin. Call, Dublin but not a fellow, admitted provost by letters patent of George III, July 15th, Member of Parliament for the City of Cork and Secretary of State. Died provost, September 4, 1794 at Buxton. This is all the mention which the published records of the college make of, perhaps, its most celebrated provost. The calendar is inaccurate as to the year of his matriculation, and it does not even tell that he was the author of The Commercial Restraints, its memorial notices being extremely scanty and brief. But in other contemporary writings, we find several notices of him, unfavorable and favorable. He was called to the bar in 1748, King's Council, 1758. Member for Lanesborough as John Hely Hutchinson of Knocklofty, 1759. In 1760, he received, in a silver case, the freedom of Dublin for his patriotic services in Parliament. He was member for Cork City as John Hely Hutchinson of Palmerston, and afterwards as Right Hun, 1761, Prime Sergeant, sometimes going Judge of Assize, and Privy Councillor, 1761, Alniger, 1763, Major in a cavalry regiment, which when threatened with a court-martial for non-attendance to duty, he sold forthwith for £3,000, Provost and Searcher of Strangford, 1774, Principal Secretary of State, 1777, MP for Tagmon, 1790, died 1794. According to the college calendar at Buxton and according to the Gentleman's Magazine in Dublin. He was also treasurer of Erasmus Smith's board and one of the commissioners for inquiring into education endowments, and he strove perseveringly but fruitlessly to obtain besides the chancellorship of the Exchequer. The most important and most historic of all these appointments was the provostship, and it is in connection with the provostship that we know most about him. He won the high office, for which, in regard of any sort of learning, he was totally disqualified by a dexterous intrigue with the chief secretary of the day, Sir John Blackwear, and those who cared most for Hutchinson considered that the maneuver was an unwise one for him. It forfeited his assured prospects at the bar, and it fastened on him the odious imputation of an insatiable avarice. The appointment, moreover, was regarded as an affront and an injury by the body over which he was placed. Fellows and scholars in various ways resented the indignity, and Hutchinson had to face a very surly temper inside the walls. He faced it with a light heart and triumphed over it, but it often turned on him and stung him. He considered that it was well worth the cost, for in the first place it was an appointment for life, and then he had not to give up his lucrative practice in the law courts, which Froude says was worth nearly £5,000 a year, and in fact he never ceased to angle for the mastership of the rolls. In the next place, he got in addition a splendid town residence, on which £11,000 had just been expended. He got an income of £2,100 a year. He got a very wide patronage, and he calculated on getting the control of the parliamentary representation of the university, which at that time was in the hands of the fellows and scholars. This last object would have been an immense acquisition for him, but he failed to win the game, the playing of which led him, according to Dugnan and others, into some of his most reprehensible courses. As has been said above, in the rivalries of public life, Hutchinson was pitted against a phalanx of as able men as ever appeared together in any country, and most of these men he supplanted and surpassed. They avenged themselves by lampooning him, and they were masters in the art. The provost was assailed in prose and in verse, in couplet and in cartoon, in newspapers and pamphlets, in the Lacrimae Academicae, Baratariana, and Pranseriana, and these two last pasquinades are unique in English literature. Their satire is as broad and as wounding as that of Junius, while it is often far more finished and playful, and there is no other instance of so many men of the same ability and station being combined in such a mosaic of detraction. Baratariana, so called from Sancho Panza's island kingdom, was written in verse and in prose, and it appeared originally as letters in the Freeman's Journal, which at that time, previous to its removal to Massena's Head in Bride Street, was published over St. Audion's Arch. The principal writers of these letters were Sir Hercules Langrish, Flood, Grattan, Yelverton, Gervis Bush, and Philip Tisdall. The volume is a collection of pieces published during the administration of Lord Townsend, and in it the Lord Lieutenant figures as Sancho, Anthony Malone as Don Antonio, Provost Andrews as Don Francesco Andrea del Bumperoso, and Hely Hutchinson, under the various titles of Don John Alnagero, Autochthon, Terray Filius, Monopolist, Single Session, and Sergeant Rufinus. It was in one of these papers that Grattan, with an audacious drollery, drew his celebrated character of Lord Chatham, as a privileged extract from a manuscript copy of Robertson's forthcoming History of America. The description given by Longrish of Hutchinson, who was not provost at that time, is, "He talks plausibly and with full confidence, and whatever proconsul is deputed here Rufin immediately kidnaps him into a guardianship, and like another Trinculo erects himself into a viceroy over him. His whole elocution is alike futile and superficial. It has verdure without soil, like the fields imagined in a calenture. He has great fluency, but little or no argument. He has some fancy too, but it serves just to wrap him into the clouds and leave him there, while he holds himself suspended, plaining and warbling like a lark, without one thought to interrupt the song. If he has any forte, it is in vituperation or abuse. In 1766, he defeated the first militia bill. His first stride in apostasy was supporting the Privy Council Money Bill in 1767, for opposing which Anthony Malone had previously lost the Prime Surgeon C in 1754 and the Chancellorship of the Exchequer in 1761. His next was in defending the motion for the additional regiments, whereby we were treated like a ravaged country, where contributions are levied to maintain the very force that oppresses it. For these ministerial services, Hutchinson got the Prime Surgeon C, with an extra salary of £500 a year. In the next session, he was useful to the Crown in regard of the Pensions Enquiry Bill and the Embargo Corn Bill, and was rewarded with the sinecure Alnager's place, worth £1,000 a year. He was made a Privy Councillor, got the reversionary grant of the Principal Secretaryship of State, and the commission of a half-pay majority, and was what Primate Stone termed a ready-money voter. He got more, says Flood, for ruining one kingdom than Admiral Hawke got for saving three. The list of the pack, one of the rhymes in the volume, has, "Yet Tistel unfeeling and void of remorse is still not the worst, Hely Hutchinson's worse, who feels every crime yet his feeling denies and each day stabs his country with tears in his eyes." Philip Tisdall, in Baratariana, gives the following humorous description of Hutchinson. "He is jealous of me and as peevish as an old maid. I love to tease him. I endeavor to put him on as odious ground as I can in Parliament, and then I am the first to complain to him that government should expose their servants to so much obloquy without occasion. I magnify to him the favors and confidence I receive from government, and my correspondence with Rigby, which nettles him to the heart. He is too finical for Lord Townsend, who makes very good sport of him. One day he dined at the castle, and when the company broke up, Lord Townsend, who pretended to be more in liquor than he was, threw his arms about his neck and cried out, "My dear Tisdall, my sheet anchor, my whole dependence, don't let little Hutchinson come near me. Keep him off, my dear friend, keep him off. He's damn tiresome." At other times, His Excellency makes formal appointments to dine at Palmerston at a distant day. The Prime Sergeant invites all the officers of state. Mrs. Hutchinson is in a flurry. They send to me for my cook, and after a fortnight's bustle, when dinner is half spoiled, His Excellency sends an excuse, and dines with any common acquaintance that he happens to meet in strolling about the streets that morning. This gemman has a pretty method enough of expressing himself indeed, but in points of law there are better opinions. My friend, the late primate, who knew men, said that the Prime Sergeant was the only person he had ever met with who got ready money, in effect, for every vote he gave in Parliament. He has got, among the rest, the reversion of my secretary's office, but I think I shall outlive him. Another note in Baratariana records that Tisdall, whose government salaries exceeded £5,000 a year, had also a reversion of the Alnager's place, with its £1,000 a year, on the death of Hutchinson, and this mutuality of reversions, no doubt, accounts for the warm affection that subsisted between Hutchinson and Tisdall. Blackwear got the alnagership as the price of the provostship, as before mentioned. Besides the alnagership, Hutchinson was obliged also to resign the Prime Sergeant's see, which was given to Dennis, but even in regard of emolument, the provostship was well worth these two sacrifices, the united income of which was only £1,300. He retained his sinecure of £1,800 a year, and the state secretaryship, and he was further compensated by the sinecure office of searcher of the port of Strangford, with a patented salary of £1,000 a year for his own life and the lives of his two elder sons. He had thus altogether, besides his lucrative practice at the bar and his own estate, about £6,000 a year, together with the provost's house, while his eldest son was commissioner of accounts, with £500 a year, and with the reversion of the second remembrancership of the exchequer, worth £800 a year, and his second son had a troop of dragoons. Pranceriana derives its title from Prancer, or Jack Prance, the nickname which was given to the provost. Restorer of the art of dancing, and mighty prototype of prancing. From his effort to establish in the college a riding and dancing school in imitation of the Oxford schools. Each college duty shall be done in dance, and hopeful students shall not walk but prance. The articles were originally published in the Hibernian Journal and Freeman's Journal, and the two volumes, which appeared in 1776, were announced as a collection of fugitive pieces published since the appointment of the present provost. The collection was dedicated to J.N.H.Y.H.N., Doctor of Laws, P.T.C., late Major in the 4th Regiment of Horse, representative in the late and present Parliament of the City of Cork, one of His Majesty's Council at Law, reversionary remembrancer of the Exchequer, Secretary of State, one of His Majesty's most honorable Privy Council, and searcher, packer, and gauger of the Port of Strangford. It attacks the provost all round with every asperity. It mocks his want of learning by calling him the Potosi of erudition. It makes fun of his riding and dancing schools, and it ridicules his boasted college reforms. Alluding to his efforts to banish card playing, there is the rhyme. You bag and baggage made them pack old whist and slam that saucy jack, ombre quadrille, Pope Joan, pique and brag and cribbage, curse set. It is obliged to admit, however ungraciously, that the provost effected some improvements. He obtained from the Erasmus Smith Board, of which he was treasurer, the £200 a year for the oratorian composition premiums, as well as the £2,500 for building the theatre, which Dugnan declares the college did not want. He established also the modern languages professorships, the latter-day English Parliament treatment of which is such a curious passage in the history of the university. Pransariana admits, too, that by the provost the park was walled in, and that common rooms inside the walls, supplied with coffee and papers, were provided for the students, that tardies, i.e. returns of students as passing into college between 9 and 12 p.m. were lessened, that chapels required to be attended by them were increased, and that the calling of examination rolls was finished by 8 o'clock in the morning, the hours of the quarterly examination being at that time from 8 to 12 a.m. and 2 to 4. Page M. Hutchinson was unquestionably very arbitrary and offensive in some of his regulations, but whether he was right or wrong, he met the same cynical measure in Pransariana. The Lacrimae, published in 1777, was the work of Dr. Dugnan alone, see note B, and in it he gives full fling to his hatred of the provost. It is an able and envenomed indictment, and the author hits his victim with the utmost roughness. He accuses the provost of violating every clause of the provost's oath, and of being guilty of every possible abuse of his high office. He, moreover, defames Dr. Leland, see note C, and the other fellows who were or became civil and courteous to the provost. Dugnan acknowledges that he set himself to be insolent to the provost. He tells what brave plans of defiance and revenge he formed, and how, after all, the provost punished him and put him down. The Lacrimae records all this in piquant and entertaining fashion, and besides being damaging to the provost's character, it is interesting still as a sort of college calendar of the period, giving antiquarian information of much value concerning the administration, economies, and discipline of the college 100 years ago. It begins with reciting the naked and unprincipled maneuver with Sir John Blackwiere, the chief secretary to Lord Lieutenant Harcourt, by which Hutchinson, a layman, was appointed provost, by virtue of the Crown's dispensing with the statute, which required the office to be filled by a doctor or bachelor in divinity. Blackwiere's origin, Dugnan says, was like the source of the Nile, only to be guessed at, and Blackwiere himself was insolent, illiterate, and avaricious. On the death of Provost Andrews in 1774, he recommended as his successor John Hely Hutchinson, who resigned in his patron's favor the office of alnager, which Blackwiere ere long farmed out at £1,200 per annum. Dugnan says that whilst the bargain was in agitation, Blackwiere represented the provostship as much more valuable than it was. He adds that Hutchinson complained loudly that he had been bitten, and that to make the best of a bad bargain he took in hands the college estate. Henry Flood was an eager candidate for the provostship, and was put off with a vice-treasurership, and a salary of £3,500 a year. Blackwiere would have given him the provostship if he could have paid a higher price than Hutchinson, and he would have sold it to a chimney sweeper if he had been the highest bidder. Dugnan says that all he knew of Flood was that he had been bought by Blackwiere, but he had no doubt that he would have made a better provost than Hutchinson. His disgust against Hutchinson is so intense that it overrides his sour nationality and his jealousy for the rights of the body to which he belonged, and he declares that he would have preferred the appointment of an Oxford or Cambridge clergyman. In the Gazette announcement of Hutchinson's appointment, his LLD was puffed, but Dugnan strips the degree of all merit by explaining that it was only an honorary one, that it had no academic significance, that every member of the Irish Parliament had a customary right to it, that it had just been conferred on an ignorant carpenter, one John Magill, and that as the climax of the prostitution, he himself, Dugnan, in his capacity of Regents Professor of Civil Law, had officially presented Blackwiere for the honor. Nonfellow, unlearned and layman, as he was, Hutchinson got the provostship, and he was not long in finding out that the constitution of the college afforded a sphere for energy which precisely suited him. By the new statutes, i.e., the charter and statutes drawn up by Archbishop Laud, the provost possessed, or was supposed traditionally to possess almost absolutely, the management of the college estates, the disposal of its revenues, the nomination of fellows and scholars, and the power of rewarding and punishing fellows and scholars. The choice of parliamentary representatives for the university rested, not as since the Reform Act, with the registered masters of arts and ex-scholars at large, with the corporate body of the fellows and scholars for the time being, all of whom were in a great degree subject to the statutable powers and underhand influence of the provost. The body consisted of 22 fellows and 70 scholars. The college was the only asylum in the kingdom for friendless merit, and Dugnan knew 5 contemporary bishops who had been fellows. All its usefulness and all its glories were swept away by the appointment of Mr., for he would not call him Drive Hutchinson. Dugnan explains that it took 5 years' hard study to get a fellowship, that the juniors were subject to incessant toil and irksome bondage as tutors, and that their single compensating prospect was co-option. The income of the juniors was only £40 a year, but the seniors at that time handed over to them the pupils to help their scanty maintenances. The natives' places were held by scholars who were Irish-born, and who succeeded to the places by seniority and diligent attendance on college duties. Scissorships were given by nomination, the provost claiming 8 nominations to one of each of the senior fellows, the previous system of election by examination having been superseded by Hutchinson. There was not one of these departments in which, according to Dugnan, Provost Hely Hutchinson did not traffic, and Dugenin's statements are borne out by the evidence before the parliamentary committee. It was the same with non-coing, i.e., allowing money in lieu of commons in the hall, the same in the matter of chambers, the same in regard of leaves of absence, the same in regard of fines, and the same in everything. In all these matters, benefits were given to those who would vote for the provost's sons, and rights were refused to those who would not so vote. The fellows in those days used to have to purchase their rooms from the college. They could be compelled by the provost to attend the lectures of the professors, and Dugnan says that the provost once ordered him to leave the law courts to attend one of these lectures. Fellows had the right of visiting the students' rooms. They used to chum together. They used to be allowed to borrow money from the college, and under this arrangement Dugnan owed £300, while Leland and others owed more. From the time of the Glorious Revolution, none but fellows had ever been made provosts, although during that period 5 provosts had been appointed. Dr. Andrews' fellowship was a sort of excuse for appointing him, although he was a layman, and Dugnan, in calculating the pecuniary losses which he sustained through Hutchinson, intimates that a similar dispensation might have been exercised towards himself if in due course he had succeeded to his senior fellowship. These losses he sets down at £3,000 actual, and £6,000 on the calculation of contingencies. The provostship was worth £2,100 a year, besides a splendid residence. A senior fellowship, we are told, was worth £700 a year, a junior fellowship including pupils, £200, scholars had free commons, and there were 30 native places with £20 a year each additional. The beadle of the university had £20 a year, the porters £5 a year with clothes and food in the hall. On an average, 2 fellowships became vacant every 3 years. All these particulars Dugnan gives, and they all are made to serve as counts in his indictment of the provost. Hutchinson had the college estates surveyed, and Dugnan makes a grievous complaint of this proceeding. He says the survey cost the college £2,000, and that it was an iniquitous device for raising the college rents upon improvements that had been effected by the tenants. He declares that from the rent raising there resulted beggary, discontent, and emigration. The renewal fines were divided into 9 parts, of which 2 went to the provost, and 1 to each of the 7 seniors. In the year 1850, the fines were transferred to the college account, and the senior fellows were compensated out of the Sista Communis. The Lacrimae tells how the provost got the large old college plate melted down and turned into a modern service, destroying the engraved coats of arms and names of the donors at an expense to the college of £400. He soon after had it moved out to Palmerston House, and Dugnan does not seem to feel at all sure about its honest return. Most of the fellows were in the provost's power by being married, and Dugnan says that he used the power tyrannically. A fellow going out on a living was allowed only 5 months' benefit of salary. Dugnan seems to hold the provost responsible for the mean and decayed condition of the chapel, and he more than once rails at him for being of mean parentage. He finds that since the time of Charles I, no provost, except Hutchinson and his predecessor, had ever sat in the House of Commons. He is obliged to admit that Dr. Andrew's conduct in private life was somewhat too loose and unguarded for a provost, but still he was better than Hutchinson, though he was told that the latter was a good husband and father. Mr. Hutchinson might be a good husband and father, but no one would think the better of a wolf because the beast was kind to its mate and cubs. Hutchinson had destroyed the seclusion and retirement of the college by infesting its walks and gardens with his wife, adult daughters, infant children with nurses and go-karts, and military officers on prancing horses. He had endeavored to institute a riding school and a professorship of horsemanship after the example of Oxford, and he had desecrated the convocation or senate hall by making it a fencing school. Dueling had become the fashion among the students under the influence of the provost's evil example, and the college park was made the ground for pistol practice. We are told further by Dugnan that the number of students then on the college books was 598, of whom 228 were intern. We see by the Liber Munerum Hiberniae that by 1792 the number of students had so much increased consequently on the liberal education spirit of Grattan's Parliament that a king's letter was obtained raising the quarterly examination days from 2 to 4. In the following year was the king's letter directing the admission of Catholics to degrees on taking the oath of abjuration and allegiance in accordance with the Act of the Irish Parliament, and in 1794 appears the first R.C. entry, Thomas Fitzgerald, of Limerick, on the college matriculation books. From that date onward, the religious denomination of pupils has always been recorded. Pranceriana, i.e., probably Dugnan, asserts that the provost, on the eve of the second election in which his son was returned, offered to supply to a voter amongst the candidates for fellowship a copy of the questions which he was to give in moral science for the ensuing examinations, and Dugnan openly says that the provost was determined that no one should be elected a scholar who would not previously promise to vote as he should direct him. He kept an electioneering agent inside the walls, a spy and a corrupter, in short, the blackguard of Mr. Hutchison. Dugnan gives a long list of the provost's insolences to himself and to other members of the body. He resisted marriage dispensations to the fellows who were his opponents, while he procured them for his creatures, Leland and Dabzak. On the death of Shoebridge the fellow, which was attributed to Hutchison's refusing him leave to go to the country for change of air, the students defied the provost's order for a private interment at 6 o'clock in the morning. They had the bell rung, had a night burial and a torchlight procession, attended the funeral in mourning, and afterwards broke into the provost's house. In the first year of his office, the provost dispersed a meeting of the scholars and some of the fellows that was held by advertisement at Ryan's in Fownes Street, the principal tavern in the city, for the purpose of nominating candidates for the representation of the university against the provost's nominees. Dugnan goes on to relate how Hutchinson discharged the various duties of the high office which he had acquired by the traffic above stated. He made an exhibition of his ignorance at a fellowship examination by suggesting that Alexander the Great died in the time of the Peloponnesian War. But ridiculous a figure as he made in the scholarship and fellowship examinations, he would not withdraw from them, because unless he examined, he could not vote or nominate at the election of the scholars and fellows. This nomination power was with him a darling object in the execution of his electioneering projects of making the college a family borough, and he abstained from no methods to effectuate his scheme. We are told at length how the provost, with the consent of a majority of the board, deprived Berwick of his scholarship for absence, because Berwick would not vote for his son, and how the visitors on appeal restored him. How he deprived Mr. Gamble of the buttery clerkship, and replaced him, on the threat of an appeal suggested and drawn up by Dugnan. How the provost refused Mr. Fitzgerald.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.